Thank you, Isaac. Our speaker today, David O'Sullivan, is the ambassador to the United States from the European Union. He's a native of Dublin, Ireland, and he is joined today with his wife, Agnes, who's here on the front row as well. Ambassador Sullivan has served a number of diplomatic posts, Director General for Trade, Secretary General of the European Commission, the head of cabinet for the Commission President, and Director General of Education and Training. He started his career in the Irish Foreign Ministry and spent 4 years in the Commission Delegation to Tokyo. He also has extensive experience in the EU social and employment policy. David O'Sullivan has a background in economics. He graduated from Trinity College Dublin, and he did postgraduate study at the College of Europe in Bruges. He holds an honorary degree from the Dublin Institute of Technology. He's also a member of the consultative board of the Institute of International Integration Studies at Trinity College Dublin. He's a visiting professor at the European College of Parma and was awarded the Alumnus of the Year in 2013 by the College of Europe in Bruges. In June 2014, Ambassador O'Sullivan was awarded the EU Transatlantic Business Award by the American Chamber of Commerce. We're delighted to have him here with us today. As I said, he's here with his wife, and they are the parents of two children. We're delighted to have him here. We'll all give a hand for Ambassador O'Sullivan.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Lynn, for that introduction. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a very great pleasure to be here at Brigham Young University, even if events conspired to prevent us from being here last Thursday. I apologize for that. We spent the day stranded in Denver due to a snowstorm. My wife and I then spent some time touring this wonderful state over the weekend. I can now say we came here in 1989 and did Bryce Canyon and Zion Canyon, and this time we completed the three, so we've done all five state national parks here in Utah. But last night we were overnighting in Boulder, and as we were driving into Boulder, it started to snow. And when we got to Boulder, they said, oh, well, you know, it's going to be snowing again tomorrow morning, so you may have some difficulty getting to Provo. So I had visions of having to ring Pete again and say, lightning may not strike twice, but snow sometimes does. But anyway, we were very fortunate to be here, and it's a very great privilege, and I look forward to having an interactive discussion with you. I will talk for about 15 or 20 minutes, and I'll put my watch down to make sure I keep an eye on the time. But I hope we can then have a question and answer session, because I sometimes often find that that's actually the most interesting part of these exchanges. I'm very grateful for this invitation. I am the European Union ambassador in Washington, and I do spend a lot of my time in that great city dealing with the administration and with Congress. But I know that Washington is not America. Indeed, I know that Washington and Brussels have in common the fact that Washington is held in about as much esteem in the rest of America as Brussels is in the rest of Europe. Now, I say that with mentioning Brussels in a slightly flippant way. Of course, I could not begin my remarks without mentioning, obviously, the horrible events of last week and the terrorist attack. We're very grateful to the great solidarity which was shown by the American people, by President Obama in his speeches when he was in Cuba, by Secretary of State Kerry visiting Brussels last week, and all the outpouring and expressions of sympathy which we've had all over the United States, everywhere we've gone. And we're very grateful for that. Of course, these events touch us all. And I know that there were four Mormon missionaries who were caught up in that attack. Thankfully, they've all survived, though some of them with quite serious injuries. And we wish the very best for them, a speedy recovery. And we regret the anguish caused to their families and to their fellow members of the church by these horrible events in which they were innocent victims, as indeed were all the people caught up in that. I'll come back to that issue of terrorism and the challenges it poses in a few minutes. But the theme of my talk is what's on the agenda in 2016 for transatlantic relations. There are two very important events about which I can't say a great deal, but it would be incomplete to talk about 2016 without mentioning them. One is the fact that, as some of you may have noticed, you have an election coming up in the United States. And the outcome of that election will be hugely important for you, but frankly also hugely important for the rest of the world. We follow with enormous interest the vibrant democratic process which will lead to the selection of the two candidates who will then compete to see who becomes the President of the United States. I can jokingly say that I'm privileged in Washington to have a ringside seat in one of the most entertaining pieces of political theater. But I also have to say, of course, that it has very serious consequences for you and for us. And I'm forbidden from making any comments on domestic U.S. policy, so I can only just say that when you come to vote, I hope that you will choose wisely. The other event which is on our minds, at least certainly on the minds of those of us in Europe, is the fact that in the United Kingdom, a very important member state of the European Union, they will in fact have a referendum on the 23rd of June about whether to continue their membership of the European Union or whether to withdraw. This is something on which I can be a little bit more forthcoming in the sense that as a lifetime European official, as an Irishman, I believe very strongly that the best future for the United Kingdom would be within the European Union, and the best thing for the European Union would be for the United Kingdom to remain with us. But at the end of the day, this is the sovereign choice of the British people. They're having their debate, which is going to run for several months, still not for as long as your debate in the election, but still for a good few months. It's a very lively and vibrant debate. And I think it's important that they be left alone to have that debate amongst themselves to decide what is the future of their country, the strong implications of the choice they will make, but at the end of the day, it's their choice. And once again, I can only repeat what I said about your elections, that I hope that when the people of the United Kingdom step into the polling booth, they too will choose wisely. Now, looking to the agenda in 2016 of transatlantic relations, obviously, one issue which is hugely important in Europe in the present time is the issue of the migration crisis. I could give a speech only on this, to be frank, and it's difficult to do justice to this subject in a few moments as part of a general overview of a number of other events that I also want to talk about. I think it's hugely important to see this in its global context. This is not a particularly European problem. We are experiencing a certain situation in Europe as a result of what is actually a global problem. There are, in fact, 60 million displaced people globally through situations of conflict or the unsustainability of their states. 20 or 25 million of those people are pretty much in the neighborhood of Europe. So we are destined by geography to have to deal with this issue probably for many, many years to come. Now, the proximate cause of the current crisis is, of course, the civil war in Syria. And I think this, once again, is not particularly a European problem. We, along with the United States and other members of the Security Council, have been pushing for years for the international community to act in order to try and prevent the horrific violence in Syria and to start a political process which would enable the people of Syria to build a better future for themselves. Unfortunately, this has not been possible, and indeed Russia and China constantly blocked attempts to get a Security Council resolution and action by the international community. So I don't think that Europe has also been the largest donor of humanitarian assistance to the neighboring countries of Syria, who had to bear the main brunt of the migration, the refugee problem. I'm talking about Lebanon, where they have 1 million people in a population of 4 million. Jordan, which has, I think, about 750,000, and of course Turkey, which now I think is home to about 2.5 million Syrian refugees. And we have been one of the biggest donors in trying to ensure that those refugees are kept in proper conditions with the UN agencies, the World Food Program. The United States is also, I think, the second largest donor of humanitarian assistance, but unfortunately it has not been enough. And the UNHCR estimates that the shortfall is about 60% of needs relative to of means relative to needs. It's not surprising, therefore, that many of these people, 4 or 5 years in these camps, often in difficult conditions, and by the way, only about 15% of them are in camps. Many of them are actually living in difficult urban conditions in these countries. No criticism of the countries. I think Lebanon, Jordan, and Turkey have done tremendous efforts to provide the best conditions possible, but the fact is the numbers are what they are, and the resources, unfortunately, are what they are, and this shortfall means that people have started deciding that going to Europe makes more sense in order to build a better life for themselves. Now, the numbers coming to Europe are alternately very small or very large, depending on how you calculate it. If I say it's 2 million refugees coming into the richest economy in the world of 508 million people, you would say this should be manageable, and you would be right. On the other hand, that assumes that we are managing it on a continent-wide level, which we frankly are not, because this is one of those examples where, while Europe is a very integrated area in many respects, refugee and asylum policy, even though the policy is decided at European level, the implementation happens at national level. And if you then break it down at national level, you see the numbers become quite different. Germany has received nearly 1.25 million refugees in the last 12 or 13 months. That would be equivalent to the United States receiving about 5 million refugees. But you take a country like Greece, which has had to deal with nearly 1 million refugees in the last 12 months, and that would be equivalent to the United States having to deal with 32 million refugees. So when you look at it in that way, you begin to understand why this problem has posed very serious issues for us as Europeans as to how we manage this kind of influx of refugees. It's also very important to understand that these are refugees. They are not migrants in the traditional sense of that term. They have international rights under the 1951 Geneva Convention, which we are committed to upholding. But this does mean that we are put in a difficult situation of managing people who cross the border, who claim asylum, who must immediately be housed, fed, looked after, have files opened on them, have their claim for asylum assessed individually, and a decision taken on whether they are entitled to be granted refugee status. And those that are not, of course, must then be returned. But this is much more difficult to return someone whom you've already brought into your country than it is to refuse somebody entry at the moment that they knock on your door. So this has proven extremely challenging. There are a number of things that we need to do better at European level, but I would want to emphasize that I think huge compassion and generosity of spirit has been shown by many people in Europe. I think the press is often very critical of how we've managed the situation, and I can also be extremely critical of what we have failed to do on occasions, but we should not detract from the enormous generosity of spirit shown by the Italian people, who for many years now have been receiving people off the boats in the Mediterranean, the people in Greece, the people in Germany, the people in Sweden, people in Austria, who've opened their homes, their houses, their town halls, their schools to the refugees. Greece, you see people in the center of Athens, refugees being assisted by families who themselves have very little, and as is so often the case, I'm afraid, in these situations, those who have least are often those most willing to give to others in need. And I think we've seen this spirit throughout Europe. It's true that 4,000 people have died in the hazardous crossing of the Mediterranean, but we've rescued 250,000 people through initially Italian naval operation and now joint European naval operation. So I'm not complacent and I'm not self-congratulatory at all. I just think that there is this very positive side to the human response which has been shown in Europe, but it has also revealed huge deficiencies in the way in which we manage these situations. The burden falls on the frontline states, Italy and Greece in this case, or those states most willing to receive refugees, such as Germany. There is not an equitable distribution across all our 28 member states. And we've also seen weaknesses in the way in which we manage our external frontiers, which is left to individual member states to manage, but which can be extremely challenging when one country, such as Greece, comes under particular strain. So we're having, if you like, much as we did in the euro crisis, when the financial crisis showed flaws in the architecture of economic and monetary union, we're discovering flaws in our management of asylum and refugee and migration policy in Europe. We're having to have more European management of the external frontiers. We've proposed the creation of a European Border and Coast Guard Service. We need more European solidarity of relocation of asylum seekers across our 28 member states so that the frontline states don't have to bear the burden. And we will also need to look at better channels of legal migration for people who are economic migrants and not refugees, but who legitimately would need the opportunity to migrate to Europe in order to build a better future for themselves, bearing in mind that we actually have a very serious demographic problem in Europe, a shortfall. If you look 5, 10 years, 20 years ahead, we have a declining population. We will need migrants. So this challenge of the current refugee crisis can also be seen as an opportunity and not just a negative factor. However, managing all this in the current political context is not simple. Migration, as you know, here in the United States, can be a politically emotional and sensitive issue. People can feel frightened by the prospect of large numbers of people from different cultures or different religious backgrounds joining their societies. And while I think some of this is motivated by xenophobia and by racism, some of it is just genuine concern from decent people, and we have to find ways of addressing those concerns and assuaging those concerns and demonstrating that, as Chancellor Merkel has said, we can manage this. We as Europeans can make this work. We can show our compassion, our humanitarian responsibilities, and at the same time reassure our population that this will be managed in an orderly and peaceful and well thought through manner to the best interest both of the refugees and the asylum seekers and of our European population. But this is clearly going to be a major challenge in 2016 and beyond, to be frank. And I think I like to quote Winston Churchill's remark about the United States, that the United States can always be relied upon to do the right thing, but only after they've exhausted every alternative. We in Europe are a bit the same, frankly. I think we will eventually find the right path on how to manage this migration crisis, but not without having exhausted some less profitable alternatives, and we will need some understanding of the way in which we work our way through this. Linked to that, of course, is the broader security agenda, because the origin of this problem is indeed what's happening in Syria. It is the unrest in the Middle East. It is the battle against non-state actors such as Daesh, Al-Qaeda before, now Daesh. It is the battle against terrorism, which we are seeing. And I emphasize, it's absolutely tragic what happened in Paris. It's tragic what happened in Brussels. It's tragic what happened here, whether that was in San Bernardino or 9/11. But we should always remember that there are many more Muslims dying at the hands of terrorists than there are Westerners. You saw what happened in Pakistan. You read the news every day. Bombs in Iraq, bombs in Afghanistan. These terrorists are striking just as viciously and indeed with much greater damage at their fellow Muslims than they are at the West. And we should very strongly, I think, resist any attempt to conflate the issue of migration, of asylum seekers and terrorism, or indeed to allow the terrorists to make us stigmatize one section of our society and drive wedges between us, because that's exactly what they want. They want us to become recruiting sergeants for their own cause, by stigmatizing certain sections of our population, by allowing hate and fear and suspicion to drive us and not to look very clearly with open eyes at the reality of what is happening. This is going to be a challenge in transatlantic relations. I think without cooperation between the United States and Europe, we're not going to be able to solve the situation in Syria, the situation in Libya, or indeed the situation, the other foreign policy challenges which we will face, whether that's the nuclear deal with Iran or whether that is the ongoing confrontation with Russia over Ukraine and the whole question of the policies of Mr. Putin. I think the cooperation we've had until now on these issues, particularly over sanctions against Russia, but also the sanctions against Iran. It was the European sanctions which I think were the driving force which brought Iran back to the table in 2012 and which enabled the historic deal which we reached last year. I know there are some divided opinions in the United States, but we in Europe, I can assure you, continue to believe that this was a triumph for diplomacy. By the way, a triumph for American diplomacy, for President Obama, Secretary of State Kerry. We think you should be very proud of what your government has achieved through this deal, genuinely putting the prospect of a nuclear-armed Iran beyond reach for the foreseeable future and creating a new conditions for politics and diplomacy to replace confrontation and the risk of war. These are important steps which we've taken together, and I'm sure we will continue to be challenged in 2016 across this whole range of foreign policy issues. Turning to a couple of the other issues, and I'm conscious of my watch and also the very conveniently placed clock at the back, actually. Thank you. There are a couple of other issues I should mention. One is undoubtedly the economic agenda, the commercial agenda. I start with the digital agenda because this is hugely important. between us. We in Europe have announced a flagship project of creating the digital single market, in other words, creating the digital equivalent of what we did in 1992 to create a single market across the then 12 member states and now 28 member states for goods, services, capital, and freedom of movement of people. We now want to move this into the digital era. I have to be careful not to sound like a Luddite when I speak in this, because I said once, well, we want to do in the digital space what we once did with the real economy. And then everyone in the room stood up and said, don't you understand? There is no longer a distinction between the digital economy and the real economy. And of course, they're right, because in fact, the revolution that is taking place with the Internet of Things is indeed the digitalization of everything. And the fact that it's precisely the merging of the digital economy with the rest of the economy that is a huge revolution which is going to drive massive change. We in Europe need to dramatically change the way we organize ourselves and break down the silos between our 28 member states with silly laws about geo-blocking or even about the costs of moving parcels from one member state to another, where the transport costs can be dramatically different. It can cost you a lot more to send a parcel from Lille, just on the frontier of Belgium, to Mons, which is about 20 kilometers away, than it would be to send it from Lille down to Lyon, which would be several hundred kilometers, just because you cross a border. And this is something which we have to change if we want to really open up the full possibilities of the digital economy in the way that you've been able to do here in the United States. This will also pose some challenges between us, because we have some divergences of views. The issue of privacy has played an important role. We've just put together a new package to replace the measures which were struck down by the European Court of Justice last year, which I hope will enable us to have a good platform for the digital exchange of digital information. But this is going to, in my view, be a continual problem, both within jurisdictions and between jurisdictions. You've had it here just recently with the Apple case and the famous iPhone. We have it with a case of Microsoft in the Second District Court or District Court of Appeal in New York, with a case where the Department of Justice wants to access email details about a US citizen but held on a server in Ireland. The debate is, what's the jurisdiction? Do you use the mutual legal assistance treaty between the United States and Ireland, or does the Department of Justice have direct access because this is an American company and it doesn't matter where the data is being held? A judgment is expected shortly, but I think we're continuously going to face these challenges with this digital agenda, and we're going to have to figure out how best to do this. I don't believe there is a huge dichotomy between the United States about privacy and security. I think you're just as concerned about privacy as we are, and we're just as concerned about security as you are. But how you bring these things together in legal concepts is going to be a continuing challenge. I couldn't talk about the economy without mentioning, of course, the trade negotiations. This is hugely important for us. We are the two largest economies in the world. I want to be precise. We're the largest economy in the world. You are perhaps the second or third, depending on how you calculate the GDP of China. But between us, we represent a huge part of global trade. And opening up new markets between us, new business opportunities, reducing tariffs, reducing red tape, without reducing our standards or the autonomy of our regulators, would be a huge plus for that economic relationship. We hope it can be done this year. It may be necessary to take a bit more time, but we are determined to do our very best to try to conclude this deal this year, if at all possible. I mention also climate change. We've been talking about snow, extreme weather. I think everyone knows that climate change is really a reality. We experience it in one way. I spent a lot of time dealing with the Pacific countries the last couple of years. They are literally sinking because of the rising tide of the rise of the ocean. These are countries facing extinction because of climate change. If you look at what is happening in the Arctic, the thawing of the Arctic is going to change dramatically the geopolitics of the world. So these are just some examples of ways in which climate change is probably going to be the single biggest security challenge we will face. We talked about migration. Believe me, climate change migration is going to be a massive reality for all of us in the years to come. So we had a breakthrough in Paris. We were very grateful for American role in that. And this administration really has taken a forward position. The deal you did with China was really instrumental in helping to make Paris a possibility. But Paris is a platform. It's not the end game. It is a platform on which we can build, but we will need to implement it. There will be several important points this year, the signing of the agreement, and then a very important conference in Washington on how to actually go forward with the implementation of the deal. And once again, very close cooperation between the United States and Europe will be absolutely essential to that. The final point I'd just like to make is that obviously transatlantic relations in 2016 will be very much a function of the future of Europe itself. I hear quite a lot of doom and gloom around the United States these days about the future of Europe, about the future of the European Union. I don't want to be Pollyanna-ish. I don't want to be naive. I don't want to say that we don't have challenges or that there are not risks. The UK referendum represents one. The migration challenge, the divergences between our member states represents another risk. But after 35 years of European public service, I can say there's hardly a year in which people were not predicting the demise of the European Union. And yet somehow it not only survives, but it thrives. Because almost inevitably, when you look at any of the problems I've just mentioned, you arrive at the conclusion that only closer European integration offers a way forward, and fragmentation offers only a way backwards. Now, we know what the way backwards in Europe means when we look at what we did in the 20th century, and I don't believe any of us ever want to go back there again. The way forward is not a United States of Europe. It's not a homogenization of the European people. You have the great motto, e pluribus unum. Our motto, to the extent we have one, will be unity and diversity. When you go to Denmark, it's always going to be Denmark. When you go to Portugal, it's always going to be Portugal. No one is suggesting that we're going to change that. One of the things that fascinates me driving around this country, and I've done a lot on this occasion, but all my life I've spent many time here, is the certain degree of uniformity. You are much more diverse than most Europeans realize, but you also have a certain homogeneity about the stores you find, the fast food restaurants you find, everywhere you travel. You have the American flag, you have the common language, more or less. But that is not what we're going to do in Europe. We are never going to have everyone in Europe trying to speak the same language. I hope, I mean, goodness knows, we actually find the same department stores pretty much in every European city. I don't consider that necessarily an improvement in the quality of life. But our countries are always going to retain their distinctive national characteristics, and they should be proud of it. They should be proud of their language, their culture, their national identity. You can be a proud Dane and be a Danish European. You can be a proud Pole and be a Polish European. But we're not trying to create a single entity. And getting that balance right, organizing ourselves in a way that has enough Europe to face the challenges we have, but not so much Europe that people feel it's a threat to their national identity, is the constant tightrope we walk in building an integrated Europe. But the message I want to leave you with is one of optimism, ultimately, about our future together, and the fact that we know that we will only solve the many challenges, and I've just touched on some of them, which are in common across the Atlantic by working more closely together. And in that, the partnership with the United States is absolutely vital. The United States has been a driving force in helping to create the European integration process. The Atlantic Alliance, NATO, represents the cornerstone of security policy for all of our member states, with the exception of those who are neutral, such as Ireland. An Irish Prime Minister famously said, "We're neutral, we just haven't decided who we're neutral against." But with the exception of the countries who, for different historical reasons, have chosen to be neutral, for the vast majority of our member states, NATO, the American alliance, represents the cornerstone of our security policy. And in the 21st century, the international liberal world order that we built together, the United States and Europe, in the 20th century, is under threat, and we should be under no illusion about that. And only by working together are we going to be able to face that threat jointly through strong transatlantic cooperation. I will stop there. I apologize. I've spent 10 minutes more than I should have, but I'll try and answer your questions succinctly. Thank you very much indeed.
If you have a question to ask, we ask that you line up to this microphone right here. This is going to be recorded, and so we'd like to get it on the mic.
A first volunteer.
Hello, my name is Joseph Heath. I'm a European Studies major. On the issue of EU-USA cooperation in foreign policy, I'm curious regarding Saudi Arabia. I know that numerous European countries have recently announced they will stop selling weapons to Saudi Arabia, and there are theories that Saudi's influence of the way they teach Islam and train imams to go to some European mosques has led to some radicalization. So I'm curious what you see the future is of the EU's relationship with this country.
Well, I think you're absolutely right. We are critical of Saudi Arabia from a number of perspectives. I think in particular the role of the extremist imams in a number of mosques across Europe has contributed to some of the radicalization and the problems we've seen. And I think we need to have a frank dialogue with our Saudi friends about that. On the other hand, Saudi Arabia does also remain an ally, and we need Saudi Arabia to be part of the solution in the Middle East. I mean, it is clear to me that we are facing, in some ways, a Sunni-Shiite civil war, a bit like we had the 30 Years' War in Europe of religion. We have to stop this. Unfortunately, I don't think that those of us who are not of the Muslim faith in the end can be the most convincing ones to do that. I think it has to be done by the Muslims themselves, realizing that this ultimately will lead nowhere. But we need Saudi Arabia to be a part of that, just as we need Iran to be a part of the solution. So I think it's possible to be friends and to respect the role of an important player in the region, while at the same time being critical about certain aspects of their policies. And I think there are aspects of their policies which we will continue to be critical of.
Thank you.
Hi, Lauren Vidler. I'm an international relations major. My question is following from your final point that you made and asking, do you think that the Brexit and the refugee crisis and the unprecedented rise in like right-wing populist parties are signalling, if not the end of Europe, a demise in like the centralised approach that's been happening to the Union?
Short answer is no, but I would say that, wouldn't I? No, I think, firstly, I do, you know, with respect, I think when you use the word centralized like that, I think it already gives an impression of a monolithic Europe, which to me is not at all the reality. I mean, it really is not. And I think in the debate in the UK, you know, to which I'm not a part, and I have no desire to be a part because I think we should leave this to the British people. But when I hear people talk about the massive bureaucracy in Brussels, the centralizing steamroller of the European Union, there's probably, you know, fewer people working in the European civil service than work for, you know, the civil administration of a small city in the UK. We are not harmonizing everything that moves. We are not creating this monolith. Every country is different. The German economic model, the German labor market model, is very different from the UK or the Irish economic and labor market model, yet they're all applying the same European rules. So how can it be that these rules are somehow forcing a degree of uniformity when in fact the opposite is the case? They are minimum standards in many cases, which we believe everyone should meet, but then beyond that, people are free to do more or do a bit less. And that identity remains. Will this crisis lead to the breakup of the European Union? I can't comment on the result of the British referendum, and I agree that that will be an important factor. We wait to see what the British people will decide. But will the migration crisis lead to a fracturing of the European Union? I don't believe so, because every crisis we see in Europe leads initially to disagreement. I mean, a bit like your own electoral process. It's adversarial. people go into meetings with different starting points. There are countries who believe we absolutely must have a reallocation, a relocation of asylum seekers across all 28 member states. There are those who say, no, no, I don't want that. And then you find a compromise. And all of Europe is built on this dialectic of different starting points moving towards a common position. The process of getting to get there is necessarily publicly rather messy. Again, Winston Churchill comes to mind about sausages and laws, the two things that you should never see in the making. But this is democracy. We are ultimately, the European Union is predicated on respect of the democratic views of 28 member states. And therefore, there will be divergences, and people will shout, and prime ministers will say, I don't agree, I'm not going to agree to this. But in the end, they'll come back 3 weeks later, and they will agree to some variant of that, because they know we have to find compromises. And I really believe that there is no problem that you can mention that we are currently facing that will be made easier by a fragmentation of the European Union. No problem that I can think of that would get easier by fragmenting, which is not to say that we want to create a super state, but we do need to do things together in order to be more effective, both in terms of our management of our own immediate space, but also for Europe to be a force for good in the world.
Hello, my name is Jessica Smith. I'm an ancient Near Eastern major. And first of all, I wanted to say thank you very much for coming and speaking with us today. It's been a privilege to hear from you. I have a twofold question. The first part of it is, how do you see the U.S. being able to cooperate more with the European Union in terms of the refugee crisis? And then the second part is, what is your advice to us as students and as members of and citizens of the U.S., what we can do? I know that there's definitely a lot in terms of foreign policy with who we back in the presidential election. There are candidates who would be good, and there are candidates who would definitely detract from helping the refugee crisis. But outside of the presidential election, we can do things as citizens going forward, and what are your thoughts on what we can do in what is going to be a long, long crisis?
Well, I agree very much with your last remark. I mean, this crisis is going to be with us for a long time to come. Even if we fix Syria, there will be, you know, there's a crisis in Somalia. If you look at sub-Saharan Africa, there are many failed states. By the way, many African countries are experiencing also the consequences of refugee crises because of conflicts in their neighbor, and many of them are struggling to cope. I think the first thing we need to do, and that the United States and Europe need to do together, we need to have more resources for this refugee issue. I mean, the big problem is that the UNHCR, the World Food Program, are dramatically underfunded. And going back to the earlier question, I think, frankly, particularly in relation to the Middle East crisis, we could ask that Gulf states, Saudi Arabia, states who are clearly not going to receive many additional refugees, could at least put more money up and become more regular funders of the UN agencies, who are the first line of international action in relation to these humanitarian crises. Of course, we should also, much of this is done by NGOs. I had the occasion to visit the LDS humanitarian facility in Salt Lake City, and this is fantastic. I think every little bit that people can do is hugely important. There are many European NGOs who are very active. But I think, firstly, we need to better fund the humanitarian space. This is a real funding crisis. I mean, it really needs a sort of Marshall Plan type level of ambition to put the money and the resources into helping refugees be received, have decent lives while pending the solving of the fundamental problem in their country. The second issue is that of solving the problems. So we need to fix Syria. We need to fix Libya. We need to fix some of the failed states in Africa. This will only be done through joint EU-US leadership. Joint EU-US leadership will not be a sufficient condition anymore. Perhaps in the 20th century it was, but believe me, in the 21st century, it will remain for many, many years the necessary condition of solutions being found. We will also need the cooperation of others, and we'll have to build those alliances and those coalitions. But that's, for me, the biggest challenge we face. And what you can do as citizens, well, I think, I want to be clear, by the way, just one thing. We would dearly like that the United States would take more refugees. But let's be very frank. I think that the numbers you're talking about of taking from Syria have gone from 10 maybe to 25,000 over a couple of years. With all due respect, even if you multiply that by 10, it's not actually going to make a major dent. So I don't think the greatest contribution the United States can do is to take Syrian refugees. That's something which, with your system, is frankly not going to be the major contributor. So it is money, finding additional resources, and it is the diplomatic effort of trying to find solutions. As citizens, I can only ask you to be engaged. I think the humanitarian issue is one of the big issues we face in the international world, and one of the challenging features of the United Nations is the responsibility to protect. Where does the border lie between the respect of the sovereignty of a country and the need for the international community to intervene when the situation within a country becomes unsustainable, whether that's genocide, whether that is civil war, whether that is mass attacks on civilian population? At what point does the international community not have a responsibility to intervene to try to end the violence or end the genocide? These are difficult issues, as we know. There's a very good book by Samantha Power, the current United States Ambassador to the United Nations, called Genocide, the Problem from Hell, which talks at length about this in a very eloquent way. But that's one of the big foreign policy crises we're going to face, and there's a big divergence of view, particularly between, say, Russia and China and the West about these issues, where on the one side the emphasis is put on the national sovereignty and the integrity of international boundaries, and on the other side there's the humanitarian and the concern for anti-genocide or situations where clearly states have broken down and are unable to look after their people in the way which is needed. And that's something in which I think you as citizens need to form a view and think about as to how we will deal with this in what will be more your century than it is mine.
Thank you for your remarks.
You were beaten.
Hello, my name is Rachel Carr, and I am a neuroscience student here. I was wondering, so you mentioned earlier that you do not believe that fragmenting the European Union would help us deal with the issues at hand. What I'm wondering is, there seems to be a rising nationalist sentiment from individual countries in the European Union. I myself, actually being French, I see in my own country that there is a rising nationalist sentiment. And so I wonder, how will the European Union deal with this rising nationalist sentiment, which seems to be taking on great proportions and seems to be quite worrisome for the European Union's future?
I don't disagree. I mean, I think we have a challenge of people putting into question European integration, globalization. By the way, you have it here. Absolutely, I see much of the debate that I see here is precisely about the same kind of issues, about America's role in the world, about whether America has been a winner or a loser of globalization, of trade. So I think we have a concern in our populations that we have to address. I was surprised some people when the European Parliament elections in 2014, quite a large number of Eurosceptic parties were elected or were elected to the European Parliament. And I said, this is good. If that's the feeling, we have to debate this, and we need this to be part of the body politic. We can't suppress these views. People are entitled to say, I don't actually like the Europe we're building. And then we have to have the debate. That's why I think the debate in the United Kingdom is extremely healthy. So don't get me wrong, I am not saying that we may not in the end reach the wrong conclusion as Europeans, we may, but I do believe it will be the wrong conclusion. But I believe we have to have the debate, and we should not, and I certainly do not, denigrate those who say, actually, I think what we've done in Europe, for example, take the question of open borders, the Schengen Agreement to dismantle systematic border checks. I'm absolutely convinced that that's a plus, And I'm absolutely convinced that reinstating those checks will be a negative. I don't believe it will add to our security. I believe it will bring economic cost. I think the way you deal with terrorism or with the migration crisis is by having policies which address those issues, intelligence sharing, more intelligent management of our external frontiers. These are the ways in which you address that. Putting up new frontiers in Europe will not work because there's 250 crossing points between France and Belgium. We're currently checking with closed borders, I don't know, 60 or 70 of those. Do we have the resources? Are we willing to recruit all the police and the border guards? We're going to waste all that energy and all that resources to police 250 crossing points? Do we really think that's going to improve our security or improve our economic well-being? Of course it isn't. So I'm not afraid of this debate, but we have to have the debate, and I willingly agree that there is a sentiment that somehow this process particularly is damaging for the less well-off sectors of society, that there are people losing out, that the elite, of which probably I'm considered to be a part, though I never felt that way myself, but okay, that somehow we're not in touch with what ordinary people are feeling, and maybe we are not listening enough to some of the sentiments of our population. And we have to get that balance right. But I continue to believe that when you sit down and you calmly look at the facts, you reach the conclusion that going back to a nationalist Europe of the first half of the 20th century will be a massive retrograde step. It will not solve our problems, and it risks to create many, many new problems for us.
Thank you.
You actually answered my question during that, so thank you.
Oh, okay, great. Give him a good grade.
All right, I'm back for more. Last summer with the Euro crisis, there was a lot of talk about Greece, the Grexit, right? Greece leaving the Eurozone. But ultimately, the choice was made to bail out Greece again and keep them part of it. And since then, Greece has largely vanished from the headlines until, I'm sure, in a few more years, they come up again as having financial troubles. I'm curious what the U.S.'s interest is regarding Greece and what we can do to help.
Well, I mean, unfortunately, Greece has not faded from the headlines, but now it's in the headlines for a different reason, right, which is the refugee crisis. And honestly, it really is amazing how, you know, you can just be unlucky to be in the wrong place at the wrong time, as Greece has found itself, because frankly, they had so many problems of their own as a result of the financial and economic crisis, so much to do to rebuild their country. The last thing they needed was to find themselves at the center of this refugee crisis. And I think one of the things that is very important is that we, the rest of Europe, has now got to show huge solidarity with Greece in facing the refugee crisis. It was one thing to put conditions about the euro bailout and the sort of IMF-style bailout conditions about structural reform, but I think Greece needs, the Greek people have shown enormous compassion, and the rest of Europe needs to show enormous solidarity with struggling Greece in this time. As I think many European leaders have said, we've already authorized the spending of nearly 700 million euros of assistance in humanitarian assistance, the first time we've authorized the payment of humanitarian assistance within the boundaries of the European Union. It's normally always outside, not for the Greek people, but for the refugees, but to help the Greek people cope with the refugees. On the financial crisis, listen, I'm optimistic about Greece's future. I don't actually share the view. I mean, you say that it was finally decided to let Greece remain. Greece chose to remain. Greece had the choice. Greece could have said, we're going to leave the euro, and we're going to, I mean, we could have a debate, and I know some of you got to be at lectures at 4 o'clock, and I was told that faced with a choice between being impolite to me and being late for your next lecture, you're all going to be impolite for me, and that's the right choice. I think for Greece to have left the euro would have been a catastrophe for that country. And I don't believe that the Argentinian example of default and massive devaluation is actually a happy economic model, particularly for a country like Greece, which does not have the commodities that Argentina had, which ultimately helped it along with the commodity boom. Greece has no such export model, and Greece is entirely dependent on tourism and on other areas, but imports massive quantities of everything it needs, from energy to agricultural goods to manufactured goods. And if the price of those things had gone up, you would have seen massive inflation and probably even greater economic hardship than we've seen. the U.S. role. I think the U.S. role is to be as helpful as they have been in trying to be supportive of finding a way through the euro crisis. I believe that crisis is largely behind us. And I think Greece, if they stick to the program and they make the reforms and they get the money, Greece too will bounce back. Ireland left the program last year. Economic growth in Ireland is now expected to be 8% this year. Unemployment has come down from 16% to 8%. This demonstrates that if you get with the program, you take the medicine, and you make the measures needed to restore the sustainability of public finances, you can turn your economy around. Yes, there will be a substantial overhang of debt, but frankly, every country in the world, including the United States, has a substantial overhang of debt, and we have to find ways of dealing with it, but I believe that Greece will also find a way forward.
Thank you.
This will be our last question.
Hello, I'm Kai Osterloh, I'm an exercise science major from Germany. I had a question concerning, because you said dividing of Europe wouldn't help in the refugee crisis. On the other hand, is like you also said there are so many open borders where people can come over, and with how do we distinguish who the bad guys are, who the good guys are, if we don't patrol all the borders in that regard?
Well, I think, firstly, I mean, I don't particularly like your use of the word bad guys and good guys. I think it's very, very important, and I'm sure you weren't doing it, but just in case somebody else would be tempted, not to conflate the migration issue, the refugee issue, and the terrorist issue. Unfortunately, most of the terrorists we have in Europe are homegrown. We didn't need to import them. And frankly, I think if people want to send terrorists to Europe, there are far more efficient ways of doing it than putting them on leaky boats and pushing them out to sea with other migrants in the Mediterranean in the hope they might make it to the other shore. My guess is that they arrive in first-class plane lounges with impeccable papers and credentials. The money behind terrorism is such they don't need to do it on the cheap. So I don't think that's our biggest problem. But the point where I agree with you is that we absolutely, what we have learned from this crisis is that in order to have freedom of movement within Europe, we need better management of our external frontiers. And we have not done this. We didn't put the investment into that, largely because, to be honest, we thought we were building a world in which we were opening frontiers, we were opening doors, not closing them. We've had a bit of a sort of wake up and smell the coffee moment with the Russian annexation of Crimea, what's happened in Ukraine, and now this migration crisis. We've learned that actually, unfortunately, we probably need much stricter policing of our external frontiers, and we can't leave that necessarily to individual member states, some of whom are better equipped to do that than others. And that's what we're now doing. So we are now reinforcing the controls at the external frontiers. You will see this if you're coming through Europe. When you come in now, they're going to check your passport much more thoroughly. There are going to be database checking of lost and stolen passports. We're probably at some point going to set up some kind of European ESTA system. So this is a lesson we've learned. So we will better protect our external frontiers. I hope not in a way of making it impossible for people to come through, but just better management of those external frontiers in order to maintain the freedom of movement within the European space. And most importantly, if we really want to protect ourselves, better intelligence sharing between our different police forces. And this is the single biggest failing we have in Europe at the moment. Just as you had it after 9/11, or you realized you had it after 9/11, we're having a 9/11 moment in Europe now. We need to think very seriously how we better organize our intelligence services in order to share information, which is the only way really to combat the terrorist threat.
Thank you.